Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love and get here today. Picket lines and picket signs, don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see, oh, what's going on.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Speak That Movement Virtual Empowerment Social, the power of speaking life. I don't know about you all, but this moment to me was needed. After looking online and watching the news and just having so many conversations, I would have never thought in a million years that this particular Speak That Movement that was already planned the beginning of the year was as needed as much as it is. So I want to thank you all for tuning in. Again, this is the Speak That Movement Virtual Empowerment Social. So if you are joining in from the Speak That Movement Facebook page, I thank you. This is going to be a very interactive experience. There's an amazing lineup of speakers, and we are going to empower, uplift, and connect. If you are not on the Speak That Movement Facebook page, I would ask you to just come on board, come on over to this page, host a watch party. If we can share videos highlighting violence, and we can share videos highlighting very traumatizing situations, my ask of you is that you can share this live video of something that will be empowering, inspiring, uplifting, and very positive. And most importantly, something that will help us just get through the times that we're in right now. So if you are on, again, thank you. Let's virtually connect. Go to the Speak That Movement page on Facebook. While you're on the page, add your name and the city in the comments. I love to know who's joining in. We've had people from all over the country join the Speak That Movement virtual events. So I want to know, where are you representing from? If you're representing from my home state of Illinois, let us know. If you're representing from my new state of Texas, let it be known. If you're representing from any place, from the East Coast to the West Coast, from the North to the South, let it be known, because I am so happy to have all of you with us today. So again, share, like, host a watch party, and bring some more people in, because we are about to have a really, really, really amazing experience. All right. So thank you to everybody who is tuning in. I will not prolong the virtual connections piece, but again, add your name, add your cities throughout as you're joining in. Let everybody know that you're here, and let everybody know where you are representing from. I really appreciate all of you for being here. So my name is Tiara M. Tucker. I am the founder, the CEO, the creator, the producer of Speak That Movement Empowerment Socials. I am the founder and CEO of Tiara PR Network and Speak That Movement. So it is my honor to present Speak That Movement Empowerment Socials. These were events that were originally held at venues in North Dallas. And due to COVID-19 and the need for social distancing, I had to evolve the dream. So the dream turned into a virtual sessions. So between business professionals and believers, we come together on the last Sunday of every month just to have an empowering opportunity to get together. So this has been amazing. I'm so grateful for everybody who tunes in, to the people that tuned in last month in April, last month in March, and also in January when we actually were face-to-face. And in February, I was actually out at another event the last weekend of the month, hosting an event for somebody else. So again, thank you all for tuning in. Again, if you're on any other page, join in on the Speak That Movement Facebook page. We'll be so happy. We'll be welcoming you with warm arms. So right now, I just want to let you all know, the point of this event is just to pause. Pause from everything taking place in the world. We know what's happening. We feel it. We feel it mentally. We feel it emotionally. We're starting to feel it physically. So I wanted us to pause, to get together, to connect with like-minded people who just want to believe and know that, you know, there's power in speaking life. We can speak life over this situation. We can speak life over ourselves. We can speak life over this country. So it's also the last day of Mental Health Awareness Month. And one of the missions of Speak That Movement and Tiara PR Network is to combat mental health issues as well as social injustices that impact people along their journeys of dream and goal realization. So I wanted to close out Mental Health Awareness Month with a guest speaker so that we can just have a great conversation. I want us to talk about mental health awareness. I want us to talk about, you know, what does mental health even mean? Why is it a taboo subject? And most importantly, what can we do to overcome any mental health situations that we may face? So I'm so happy to say that Alisha Woodall, she joined. We've been knowing each other for actually a few years now. She was actually one of my speakers at my very first Speak That Movement event in Dallas years ago. So it's an honor to have you back. So Alisha, how are you?
I'm doing as well as can be expected. I'm doing good. Thank you. How are you?
I'll just say ditto.
It's hard to say doing great because, you know, most of us are kind of in our feelings. We feel that. We feel what's happening. So I'm doing as well as to be expected.
That's good. Well, I'm so happy to have you on. I know that you offer a very amazing perspective, you know, as the founder of Finding the Foundation. It's an honor to have you on. So, like I say, we have a little history, so it's always good to have a girlfriend on. So how about if you tell people a little bit more about you and your business?
Great. So my name is Alisha Woodall. I'm a licensed professional counselor here in Dallas, Texas. I've had a private practice about 15 years now, which is unbelievable. Even when I say it out loud, I'm like, I'm not even that old. So I've been in practice for about 15 years, and my practice specializes in heightened self-awareness, which essentially means helping people understand how their thoughts and feelings contribute to their behavioral patterns. And so by understanding how those things work, we understand how we move, and we can make changes based on that awareness.
Nice. And you're located here in Dallas, right?
We're in Dallas. Yep. If you're familiar with Dallas, it's the Addison area, but it's still a Dallas address. So near the tollway and Galleria in that area.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about mental health. So again, we're concluding Mental Health Awareness Month. So any stats or any information that you'd like to share with the audience about mental health?
Well, so I think it's what's to kick it off, let's at least start off with the fact that everybody has mental health issues. Just like you have physical health, we all experience mental health issues to some degree, some more severe than others. And so when you talk about stats and it says, you know, 16 million people suffer from depression, the reality is that we have all at some point in our lives felt or experienced a depressed state of mind. Doesn't mean we were full-fledged clinically depressed, but we felt a depressed state of mind. And when we start thinking of mental health in that way, that mental health impacts everyone, not just the mentally ill, not just somebody who's having a crisis or, you know, who's having a psychotic break. Those are the extreme examples. But we really need to start thinking of mental health as far as a human thing and that we all experience it. So right now that we are experiencing the grief and the loss and the trauma that is involved with that in the system and, you know, seeing people that we know and love hurt and harmed on social media, all of that creates some feelings inside of us that if you're experiencing that, you need to know that's very normal. And I think that if we understand that it's something that would happen from those experiences, we're more apt to express it, to talk about it, and to seek the help that we need when it becomes overwhelming. But we have to first acknowledge that it's not just them or them over there that experience it, it's all of us. We all experience mental health concerns.
Yeah, that's very good that you stated it that way, because unfortunately, there's such a stigma, you know, it's such a taboo topic to acknowledge mental health, you know, anxiety, stress, depression, and so many more, you know. But what are your thoughts on why it's such a stigma or taboo topic, particularly in the African-American community?
Well, so there's two things dealing with the African-American community. One being that seeking mental health at, you know, even just a very few years ago was not as easily as accessible for Black people if you wanted a therapist who looked like you and you didn't feel like you were going to someone who was outside of your community with your personal woes. So that was one barrier that we've had that has now, there's so many therapists of color, people who are who know how to work with people of color, that's changed now. So that was the first thing. There was a barrier there. It wasn't something that was a norm in our community to do. It was just not normal for us to go out, sit in somebody's office and talk about the woes of our inner lives and our families. So that was the first thing. But then the second thing is the stigma of this strength. And to believe that if I'm strong, I can't have any type of mental health anguish, any type of anxiety or depression or anything that does not exemplify and look like, you know, super strength. And so we have that working against us, the fact that one, we don't talk as much outside of our homes, and then two, we want to present as if we're okay all the time and strong. Those two things together have been the greatest barriers to Black people seeking mental health services, right? And even believing that mental health is impacting them. We'll talk about the uncle that may be sick, that acts a little weird, and he's crazy, but we won't necessarily talk about our own personal struggles with depression or sadness or anxiety, right? When it's debilitating and things of that nature. So first, just one, changing the way we see it, and then talking more about it amongst ourselves, making it more comfortable. You talk about erasing the stigma. That starts when we educate ourselves on what mental health is, what it really is, and it's not just psychosis.
Yeah, that's good. That's really good, and I'm excited to see more and more organizations. Mm-hmm. My sister girl, Taraji P. Henson, you know, her foundation, yeah. And just more and more your organization. So it really is a blessing to see that there are more organizations out there that are helping people overcome and just giving people an outlet, just to talk, to go, to find another resource.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So given all that's going on, you know, you touched on it a little. I know I touched on it in the beginning, but from COVID-19, which actually, when I first started planning this event and when I reached out to you,
yeah,
my thought was that it would be mental health regarding COVID-19. Yeah. You know, I also knew that I wanted to touch on some of the social justices, injustices going on, but I didn't know when I planned this event that the nation would be in an uproar like this. Yeah. Wouldn't have known, which is even more reason for me to feel like this is more of a divine event than I even knew.
Yeah.
So speak on that a little bit more. Like, what tips or what best practices or what words of wisdom can you offer people who are struggling right now? Because I'll be honest with you, Alisha, you know, I've had tough skin. You know, I've been involved with different areas of the movement over the years. But something about this weekend, yeah, I don't know what it is. You know, perhaps it's looking at the fires. I mean, maybe it was this particular incident that happened with George Floyd. But talk to us about what can we be doing, or what can help us maybe think a little differently or alleviate the pain mentally?
Yeah. Well, I think it goes back to what we were just talking about as far as at least acknowledging that it exists. A lot of times, if it's a very common phrase in our community, is I feel some kind of way, right? That's a very common thing to say. People don't really question you when you hear it. I feel some kind of way just means you're feeling something. We struggle with the ability to identify and to label what we are feeling. And so because of that, we typically don't talk about it or do anything to alleviate it, anything that's at least helpful in that way, right? There are some other things that we can do that are not helpful that you may end up doing and not even realizing it's because of how you're feeling. So when we acknowledge that we feel some kind of way, anxious, sad, distraught, grief, hopeless, helpless, all of these feelings and emotions that we may have inside of us, when we first acknowledge that, we then can express it to other people, whether that's to your loved ones or to a therapist. I'm always an advocate of therapy. I think everyone should have a therapist in their pocket. But the ability to express that I am feeling something and then putting a label on what that feeling is, what that does, it allows it to be real for you so that you can now address it, right? If you have a toothache, you acknowledge, I have a toothache. You call someone, you say, I have a toothache. And the person that is that's equipped to help you with that toothache then does so. Some things that we can do on our own independently without therapy, without actually going to see somebody, which I still am an advocate for, is to always get sunlight. It seems so natural and intrinsic, but sunlight helps, right? It rejuvenates us. The vitamin D is helpful to the spirit and to the mentality. there are certain foods that we can eat, right? There are certain things that we can do, like drinking lots of water and getting lots of rest. These things seem so simple, but when you think about how it helps brain functionality, it has to help the way that our mind functions as well. Doesn't mean it takes away the pain or the sadness, but it does help us operate at our higher level. We also want to be mindful of our functionality, changes in functionality, right? If I'm sleeping less or sleeping more, if I'm eating less or eating more, anything that changes in my normal routine or pattern that may indicate my emotions are having a ripple effect to my behaviors. Those are also things that you want to be able to see, take note of, and if necessary, ask somebody for some assistance.
Very good. Thank you for sharing that. And this is an interactive experience, everybody. So if you all have any tips or any best practices that you have found to work for you, please, please, please add them into the comments. We are here to empower each other and to connect with each other. So I know for me, I have been practicing mindfulness. It's something I've been practicing for about a year now. So from meditation, going out, having, you know, mindfulness walks where I'm observing, mm-hmm. you know, the trees, the plants. I mean, the little things that we really do take for granted right. in life. So inspirational music. So all those things. So guys,
if journaling is another one that's really good as far as insight and introspection. Journaling, writing things down can be really helpful.
Awesome. Well, thank you. And again, I'm so happy to have you with us and everybody. Alicia's going to come back up. So she's going to come back in a moment for some Q&A. So if you have any questions or anything comes to mind, please hold your questions. You can put them in the comments if you want. But if you want to have us actually acknowledge your questions, stay tuned because Alicia's going to come back up after the second speaker. And we're going to ask you just some more questions and we're going to get some more answers. So again, I thank you so much for joining. Again, Miss Alisha with Finding the Foundation. You can find her on Instagram as well as at www.findingthefoundation.com. But again, she'll be back up in a moment. So thank you so, so much. We'll talk to you in a moment, okay?
Okay, thank you.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for people that are continuously joining in. Please, 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 if you're not on the Speak That Movement Facebook page, join in so that you can actually be a part of this event. This is a very interactive event to virtually talk and interact. Go to the Speak That Movement page. Thank you to everybody out there that is hosting a watch party or who is sharing this live event. As I said earlier, if we can share negativity or traumatizing things, or you know, if we can share things that, you know, really don't sit well with us that we're seeing, please, please take this opportunity to share something that's positive, something that was created to be empowering, inspiring, and uplifting. So please, if you haven't already, let's share this, let's help, and let's heal as many people as we can over the next hour. So again, my name is Tiara M. Tucker, founder and CEO of Tiara PR Network and Speak That Movement. And I am so happy to have you all on. We just heard from Alisha, who talked about mental health and helped us kind of think about different best practices and tips regarding how we can just do some day-to-day things and activities to help us cope with any mental stressors or any mental feelings that we may be facing. So I am extremely happy to invite to the Speak That Movement platform my next guest. It is such an honor to have our guest speaker, Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III. So again, I really do feel like this is a divine event because when I first reached out to Dr. Haynes, I was just thinking, oh, this would be great to conclude Mental Health Awareness Month. I knew he would be an amazing person to speak life to us, to speak life over us. And I truly respect the position that he plays in the communities, within the nation, and around the world. So without further ado, I am going to bring to the Speak That Movement platform the Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III. Everybody, give him a virtual round of applause. I want to see some fist pumps, some waves. I want to see smiley faces, love symbols, everything, because I am really honored to welcome you to this platform.
Wow. It's my honor. I appreciate you. I appreciate your spirit. And thank you for allowing me to be exposed to Alisha, how powerful and moving and insightful she was. And then let me applaud you for being you. I won't forget when we met at an event and you were in full service mode and being just extraordinarily wonderful, winsome, and kind. And so I just need everybody to know who's watching the warmth that you are experiencing through this virtual experience is just who she is. She is just about serving people, loving people. And I just want to salute you for being T must mean tremendous. So thank you very much for being who you are.
Thank you. And you know what? I still laugh about that event when I was there, because I asked you probably 10 times, you sure you don't want anything to eat? I really think my nerves. Right. I'm like, you're not hungry. You don't want anything to eat. Right. And that was a major event last year in Dallas pertaining to social justice. So it was amazing to have you there as a speaker. And I have another funny moment that I want to bring. And I don't know if you will even recognize or remember this, because it happened so fast. So this was last year, and I was at the courthouse for a big trial taking place. You were at the courthouse for a big civil rights trial. And I remember I was talking to someone right where all of the media was, like every major local national media outlet was in Dallas at this courthouse. And I was there talking to someone. You came, and then you started talking. And then what I didn't realize was that you two were about to have a press conference. So you and Dominique, that's who it was, you all went up in front of the cameras. And I'm just along the wall, like, oh, let me listen. And I remember Dominique said, come over here. And I was like, uh-uh. So I went anyway. So here I am at this national press conference.
Right.
Standing like by your side / behind you. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what is he about to talk about? What is he about to say? Like, what is about to happen? So I just want to say that was one of my funniest moments, because I was like, should I be a ghost? Should I disappear? Should I walk away? All I know is you were talking about firing somebody. I mean, you were going in, but it was all for the love of justice. So I just wanted to tell you, remind you of that moment.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, you're always in the right place, standing for the right thing. That just speaks volumes of who you are.
Thank you. So for people that do not know you, I mean, I can very well say that you're the prophetic pastor of Friendship West Baptist Church in Dallas. I can say that you are a major social activist who I highly respect. I can say that you're an author, you're a speaker. I can say that people may know you from the Ricky Smiley, let me not say Tom Joyner, the Ricky Smiley, the Ricky Smiley Morning Show. But for those who don't know you, tell us a little bit more about you and tell us about your journey.
I appreciate that. The best way for me to respond to a question like that is to just basically say my name. My name is Frederick Douglass Haynes III. Of course, those of you familiar with history connect my name with the name of the abolitionist, the social justice warrior, Frederick Douglass. But I'm the third, so I'm named after my grandfather. And my grandfather's story is that he was orphaned at the age of 4 and basically raised by a sister, and she called him Bubba the entire time that she was raising him. He goes to school at the age of 9, and while she's raising him, she's reading to him because he can't go to school for whatever reason, having to do with segregation and racism. Finally goes to school at the age of 9, and she had been reading to him about Frederick Douglass. And so when he arrives at school, the teacher says, okay, and what is your name? And again, keep in mind, this is 1909 in the last century. And when she says, what is your name? He responds to her, my name is Frederick Douglass Haynes. And right in that moment, he defined himself. And one of the great principles I've discovered from that is that life is not so much about discovering who you are as it is deciding who you are. He decided who he would be, and his life trajectory reflected that. He became a pastor in California. During his pastorate, he was the first African-American to run for county supervisor in San Francisco. He hosted Martin Luther King Jr., the NAACP National Convention, W.E.B. Du Bois. I mean, just a social justice activist. And so that's really in my blood. It's in my DNA. I didn't know all of this about him, but I share that with you because he died when I was 10 years old. So all I knew was that he's granddaddy. I had no idea he had done any of what I just shared with you until much later in life. But for some reason, and you have used repeatedly the whole concept of a divine moment, which means God is very intentional. God orchestrates and orders steps and stops. And I fell in love in school with Frederick Douglass because my name is Frederick Douglass Haynes. I had no idea of my grandfather's story. And so the more I read Frederick Douglass, the more I'm feeling Frederick Douglass and just imagining that my life story would, in the 20th and 21st century, somehow be informed, inspired, and influenced by Frederick Douglass. And so when you hear about our ministry unapologetically unites in holy wedlock Jesus and justice, because they never should have been divorced. Jesus was about justice. And for me, a real walk of faith is one that involves not just my personal spiritual development, but my social activism and responsibility and commitment to making the world a better place. So that is a long answer to your short question. But again, that Frederick Douglass says so much about informing who I am and what I'm about.
That was a powerful question to my short answer. You have a round of applause out there. You introduced yourself much better than I would have. That is pretty profound. Wow. I mean, that is very profound. So thank you for sharing that amazing history and bio. So I want to, with all that's going on in the world, I know we're going to have comments throughout, and I'll pull some of the comments up a little later because I want us to have a conversation right now. So, Dr. Haynes, as I would like, I don't know if I should call you Frederick Douglass now, Frederick Douglass Haynes. I want to call you Dr. Haynes, okay? So, with all that's going on in the world, I mean, as I just mentioned with Alisha, I'm just going to jump right to the chase on it, right?
Right.
Tell us, what are you feeling? You know, we think about COVID-19, and when we think about the mental health issues and stressors that were already taking place, and then now we think about the social injustices that you and I both and so many other people know, this has been going on a lot longer than what we're seeing virally during the month of May. So when you think about all of this, what is Dr. Haynes feeling?
Well, and let me just thank you for asking that question, because I'm hoping that everyone listening will honestly answer the question for themselves. I mean, how are we feeling? As you know, Black people love to fake it till we make it. And it's rare that we answer for real, what's going on. And so that's my prefatory statement, because I have to say, I mean, honestly, I'm feeling overwhelmed. I battle on a constant basis anger and anxiety. And at the same time, I get down, and I'll even name it. There are moments when I've been depressed during this time. And it's just crazy when you think about it that, you know, COVID-19 is enough by itself, but then you have the news in April that it's disproportionately hitting Black people. And it's like, God, with all the hell we catch, you gonna add this too? I mean, can we get a break somewhere? Because you, I mean, and y'all know at the beginning of it, there was a little rumor, grapevine, Black folk don't get COVID-19. Black folk,
right?
And then we end up getting more than everybody else. Right. And so I'm tripping, like, because at the beginning, you know, full disclosure, let me just be honest with you. Don't judge me.
There's no judgment zone. The Speak That Movement platform, transparent, unfiltered, unscripted, uncensored.
I love it. So when it first, when the grapevine and the, you know, and the Negro Net was saying that, you know, Black folk don't get it, I was saying, whoa, finally, we don't get something that everybody else can get. Wouldn't it be beautiful if melanin was an anti-COVID-19, you know, antidote? Would that not be awesome? And then, you know, Black folk dying more, tested less. And so that gets overwhelming. And I'm sure you can relate to this. You know, I've been busier during this quarantine than I have my entire life. And I'm known for being busy, but I've never been this busy. Never been this stressed, never been so like drained. There's the word I've been looking for. So mm-hmm. So when I think of this, I mean, drained, overwhelmed. And then it's like, after all of that, then we have Ahmad, Brianna, George.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, the psychic battle that we have to deal with, because there's an assault on our spirit, our sanity, that is just nonstop. It's like, you know, one wave comes in, and just when we think we can catch a break, here comes the next wave. And then the next wave is even bigger than that. And when you get hit by so many waves, it starts to literally wear you down and wear you out. And, you know, I'm a man of faith. I love God so much, I can't express it. But I'm not gonna lie, I've had during this crisis some dark moments when, you know, me and God have had to throw down. And I mean, I was doing the throwing down. God was just probably looking at me tripping. And then there have been times when I've just said, I just can't take it. I just can't take it. One of my most painful moments, you know, occurred last week. And my daughter told me she just started crying for no reason. And yet the reason was, you know, watching, you know, George Floyd, you know, with the knee in his neck, and an officer who had no regard for his humanity. And I'm not going to lie, that hit me. And I find moments where I'm fighting back tears, because this is just an overwhelming season.
Yeah, I agree with everything that you said. And in particular, since you mentioned George's name, I don't know what it is. I mean, and you know, there have been so many unfortunate murders involving police brutality. As I tell people all of the time, some things you see it because it went viral. But there are things locally, weekly, monthly, right, that don't even hit mainstream.
Right.
There's people right now in their own families who may have examples of injustice or discrimination or whatever. So I want to hear your thoughts, you know, as a pastor, a man, a person, a human being, what do you feel that about the George Floyd situation? You know, what is it do you feel about this one where it just feels like it hurts?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I'm both heartbroken and hostile. The hostility comes from, you know, again, and then watching that, I don't want to even call him a man because he's not worthy of being called that, but watching him kneeing the neck of someone who's already helpless, who is pleading for his life, even calls for his mother, a 46-year-old man, you know, calling for his mother. And to see no compassion. And I had a conversation with one of my members, Lee Merritt, who's an attorney for Ahmaud Arbery's family. And he's up in Minnesota right now. And he said, and I said, man, you know, people want to know what we can do. And he said, one of the first things we have to do in this country is to decriminalize Black skin, because the only way that you can put your knee in the neck of someone and then audaciously look in the camera like this don't bother me, you know, and here, and then do it for almost 9 minutes. And for over 2 minutes, he's unresponsive. I mean, you don't see this person as a human being. You see them as criminal. You see them as unworthy of life and living. And so when I think of George Floyd, I think of the fact that unfortunately there are too many in this country. And let's be honest, the DNA of this country denies the humanity of Black people. I mean, let's be honest, the DNA of this country, you know, 3/5 of a human being, that means we're not fully human. That's written in our founding document. And then treated as property during slavery, but not really as good as property, you know. And further, it gets worse because after slavery, still not seen as human. And so the slave patrols, the Black codes are enacted. Someone, one of your very conscious listeners pointed out 99 years ago today, this day, 99 years ago, Tulsa, Oklahoma, Greenwood, I'm sorry, Black Wall Street was the victim of a massacre. Again, you don't see people as human when you do that. And the unfortunate reality is that we still live with the offspring of those who have always felt that way. And that is heartbreaking, that we still in 2020 are being treated as less than human. When, you know, they call her Karen on social media, Amy Cooper last week, Memorial Day, same news cycle as George getting killed, you know, thought she could, she's breaking the law there in New York, not having her dog leashed, but she had the nerve to say, I'm gonna call the police on you and say there's an African-American. Because again, that's the criminalizing of my Black skin. And so it's like all of this, I mean, again, COVID-19 says that my Black skin lets me know that racism is a public health issue. But then Amy Cooper and that racist terrorist of a police officer says that my Black skin is weaponized, it's criminalized and dehumanized. So when I hear George Floyd, my heart breaks, and then I'm just, I gotta be real with you. I'm tired of this. I mean, this is happening on repeat. It's not like this is a first time event. This has been going on. And what you said earlier, I just hope we get. George Floyd was on camera. You know, someone was there. We have no idea how many of us have been subjected to that kind of police state sanctioned violence, and it never was caught on camera. I'll put it like this. I don't know a Black person who does not know someone who has not been victimized by police violence.
Wow.
That ain't cool.
Yeah, that's deep. That's really deep. And you said a lot, and I'm so thankful for your transparency. And so as a Black man, like, let's take away everything, you know, you're Frederick, right? How does that feel knowing that, you know, if when you think about the victims and knowing that that could be you, that could be me, that could be our cousins, that could be our coworkers, it could be anybody.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and I hate to say it, but it's just real. I mean, there's a feeling of helplessness. There's a feeling of dread when I'm driving and there's a police car close by. And I automatically am hoping I don't have a busted taillight. I'm hoping there's nothing wrong with my car. I'm hoping that I'm driving the speed limit and less. I'm just hoping that. And I mean, imagine the anxiety that I see a police car And whereas Amy Cooper would see protection, I see probable death.
Yes.
You know, I see, you know, the fact that, and again, here's what gets me with George Floyd. And that is, you know, they say this all went down over a $20 bill that was, you know, not legit. So a $20 bill being not legit is a death sentence. And so, again, it just speaks of the devaluing of Black life, of the criminalizing of Black skin. And it just makes me feel like, again, you know, Gayle King said it so well on Tuesday morning. She was reporting on this. She said, it's open season.
Yes.
And if it's open season, and this is not a safe place for Black men, a safe place for Black women, then we live, if we're not careful, in a constant state of fear. There is, for Black people, unfortunately, a pandemic within this pandemic. And
yeah,
that pandemic is the virus of what? Racism, of white supremacy, that again criminalizes, dehumanizes, and even demonizes me. I'm just, you know, it's a heartbreaking season.
Yeah. And I know earlier we mentioned, you know, the stigma around mental health, you know, the taboo word of depression or anxiety. Let's talk briefly about that taboo word of racism and discrimination.
Yeah.
And then this is something that maybe I'm personally dealing with, and I'm pretty sure other people are listening in and maybe dealing with it as well. But I think something where I'm just trying to get a little peace is, you know, we've been living this, right? We've been living this. And I'm, first of all, let me say, I am happy to know that other races, and I won't just say white races, I'll say other races,
right,
are starting to maybe open their eyes more, open their right, ears more. Or maybe when we turn on CNN, we see that it's not just African Americans out there looting. It's not just African Americans out there in those cities fighting police officers during these protests. So we're seeing more of a diverse outpouring and a more diverse, like, anger and frustration. So I guess for me, where I'm just kind of struggling is, how do we keep that conversation going? You know, today is Sunday, right? From
right,
Friday to Sunday, everybody's just, you know, whatever. But guess what? We got to go back to work Monday.
Yeah.
And on Monday, there's going to be silence. There's going to be this uncomfortable feeling. So any thoughts that you might say around, like, that feeling of, it's so taboo, but it's so real. But we have to kind of talk about it in certain circles. And, you know, do we say the right word? People are editing their posts. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. And I'll say, you speak that movement as a motto, because mm-hmm, you could have easily ignored this today. You could have just, I mean, this is what, Mental Health Awareness Month. This is the last day of Mental Health Awareness. You have the brilliant Alisha to share earlier. And you could have easily said, well, I'll just focus on that. But you decided, I'm going to have us wrestle with, and I love it, in the context of mental health awareness. Because, and Alisha, I'm not going to take her job because she can speak this better than I can. You know, racism can make you mentally unhealthy. Racism can, so you can be so inundated with psychic attacks that those psychic attacks start to wear you down. Some of our depression. There's a wonderful book by Terry Williams called Black Pain. It just looks like we're not hurting. A powerful, profound book about Black depression. And she basically unpacks the fact that we as a people have done a good job of disguising the impact of racism on us. There, she even quotes Langston Hughes, because my mouth is wide with laughter and my throat is deep with song, you do not think I've suffered after I have held my pain so long, a pain that has been imputed onto me by racism. And so you've had the courage, I call it the moral courage and the moral imagination to say, I'm going to use my platform. Please don't miss this to everyone listening. Tiara says, I'm using my platform to address something that may not be comfortable. And I think all of us have a personal responsibility, if we are going to heal, to have the moral courage to start and create platforms for uncomfortable conversations, because you will not heal from what you do not deal with and what you ain't real about. Now, that was good.
That was so good.
Okay. I hope I can. You will not heal from what you will not deal with and what you ain't real about. I mean, it's a remix of what James Baldwin said, that you basically will not fix what you will not face. And so I think that it's going to take all of us having the moral courage to say, we're going to have this uncomfortable conversation. What do you feel? You raised a question that I think everyone needs to answer. When you think about what happened with George Floyd, how did that make you feel? And I think every person on the planet, because I'm hearing from, I got friends in South Africa, Zimbabwe, London, who are hitting me up about this. And because it's a human situation, it's a human problem. And I love that. And I think we need to go ahead and be able to freely answer the question. How do you feel when you think about George Floyd, when you see that video? And then go ahead and ask that question to other people in our circle. Well, how did you feel? How did you feel? Because a few of my colleagues have hit me up and they said, Pastor, listen, I'm angry and I'm just angry. I don't know what to do. And I said, well, if you're conscious and you have a conscience, you better feel that way. Now, if you ain't conscious, then you ain't gonna feel that way. If you don't have a conscience, you ain't gonna feel that way. If you don't have a heart, you're not gonna feel that way. And so I think we ought to ask that question, because the answers that the people give is gonna let you know if they got a heart, if they're conscious, and if they have a conscience.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you for that, Pastor. I appreciate that. Lots of comments coming in, and I'm so excited to open this up in a moment for Q&A. But I want to ask you another question before we go into Q&A. Mm-hmm. For the people, let's say, who don't have a platform, who you know, maybe they're thinking, well, I want to do something. You know, I have a voice. How do I use it? And how can I do more? Things like that. What are your thoughts on that for the folks that, you know, people are looking for something, like, how do I help, or what? How can I contribute? So any thoughts on that?
Well, I think that, I mean, everyone has a responsibility to hear what the divine is saying to them in their ear, in their spirit, as to what they can do, because we're not all wired to do things that, you know, others may be wired to do. And so I'm saying, you know, ask God, okay, God, so what can I, what platform can I create? And I use that intentionally, because Speak That Movement was created by someone who heard from God. And God, I mean, you keep saying this is a divine kind of thing here going on here. So you created a platform, but I dare say there's a divine connection that has ordered your steps, opened doors, and connected you with people. So I think that all of us can say, okay, look what Tiara has done. I can do that. I can create a platform. Platforms don't always come ready made. Every now and then you got to build one. And when you build a platform, it's yours. It's what God gave you. And you basically control the theme and the message of that platform. So I think it's very important that we all hear from God as to, okay, God, you know, what platform have you given me? What platform do you want me to create? in this space, because if I'm not a part of the solution, I'm definitely going to be a part of the problem. And that's my thing right now. If you ain't a part of solving this thing, creating a new normal, then maybe you're a part of the problem, just sitting on the sidelines watching life happen. So all of us can do something. Social media has leveled the platform playing field. So if you have a social media account, you can raise questions. You can say what Tiara dared to ask me tonight. When you think about George Floyd, how does that make you feel? And then let people respond. And I promise you they will.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's good. I love that a lot, that, you know, it doesn't always have to be something major or humongous or overproduced or super thought out. It could simply be picking up the phone and calling a loved one and say, hey, how are you feeling?
Yeah.
Or texting people and saying, let's talk about our feelings, because what we don't want to do is keep them bottled in, right?
Thank you.
That's not good.
Not at all.
So I appreciate that. And I'm going to ask you one more question before Q&A. When you need to be uplifted, when you need inspiration, what does Dr. Haynes do? What do you do?
Thank you for that. Number one, I love, and you all referred to it earlier, meditation for me is a way of centering, so that what's happening around me does not define what's going on within me. So meditation for me is super important. The other piece is music. Music has a way of lifting, and I have a playlist. Don't judge me. But I have a playlist that.
Who's on my playlist?
Oh, I can't even tell you. But it varies. It will go from if I need to jam, you know, I mean, the Queen Bee, Beyonce. I got to go with the Queen Bee, and then, you know, and I'm trying not to say this, but you're making me just we're transparent right here. We're transparent. Thank you. I mean, there's some rap artists that. I mean, Nipsey Hussle speaks to my soul. Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole, the poetry of, I study the poetry of Jay-Z, because I mean, how he, you know, the bars, the brilliant bars. So that starts to distract me from what's going on around me. And then, you know, the sounds of blackness with optimistic and I believe, and that will lift me. I'll jam with the Queen of Soul, and then I'll bring it on around to gospel music. And what's really been killing me these days is Kirk Franklin's most recent piece he did on Smile. And I mean, Kirk is going to always get my juices going. It's just so it's meditation and music that basically helped me to start to pull it together. And then you mentioned something earlier, and I'm really glad you said that, because it freed me up to say it. And that is, I mean, COVID has given me a chance to do what I have not done, unless I'm in New York or downtown Chicago or San Francisco. And that is, I've started walking in Dallas and doing these meditation walks. I literally accepted my call and discovered my purpose doing meditation walks, and then stopped it. But that's what I'm doing now. I mean, I just get out and I just walk, and then I'll mix up the walking with some sprinting so I can get a little cardio in. And it's just a beautiful thing.
Good. Well, thank you for sharing that. And I'm vibing with your music list. So, okay, nice to know. and everybody in the comments, Phil, let us know. What's your favorite songs? What are some songs that you like to jam to? And speaking of Kirk Franklin and Fred Hammond today.
Right now. Yeah. So, you know, I love you because I'm giving that up.
Yep. Shout out to Dallas.
Up until this.
Yes. Yeah. Kirk Franklin, Fred Hammond, we give you much love. All right, so guys, right now we're gonna open it up for you all, but please don't leave yet because we're not done. There's more to come. Dr. Freddie Haynes and I have more to talk about, and he's going to close us out at the end with a powerful word. So if you have not already shared this or hosted a watch party, please do. We need to pull in even more people, because if you think the first half was good, it's about to get even better. So right now I'm going to pull in our sister, Alisha, and we are going to open it up for some Q&A. So if you all have any questions, please add them into the comments, and we may not be able to address all of them, but we are going to do our best to address anything that comes to mind. This Speak That movement is about speaking. Words have power. Your questions have power. And my prayer is that the responses will have power. So go ahead and throw out your questions and we will pull them up. Or any comments that you may have as well.
I know, Pastor Haynes, that was a word. So I appreciated that. I was listening from the backstage and you said so many good words. I see you have a question now. I just wanted to add that.
Thank you, Alisha.
Well, I was inspired by you. Thank you. I rode your wave.
Hey, I'll take it.
That movement is about connections, everybody. So make sure you add your name and your comments and your city and your businesses in the comments so that we can connect. So we have a question from Natalia Bailey. Hey, Natalia, representing my hometown of Kankakee, Illinois, and now living in Dallas. So Natalia wants to know, how do we explain this to our youth? So I'll let you two take that away.
That's a question for a great counselor.
It's a great question. Well, it's twofold. So in part, I think we explain it, but you also want to do more listening because they know what's going on. They're on social media. They hear, they see what's happening. They see what's on the news and what's going on around them. So the question is, starts off with, what are you experiencing this? What are you feeling? What are your thoughts on this? And then you can provide some backdrop, some real information regarding systemics, history, things that they may not have insight about. But we really want to check in with our teens and our youth and see how are they feeling right now. Because a lot of times we just expect that they're okay. No one's asking them, how are you feeling? They feel the same things that we're feeling and on a different level because they also have no one else to express it to. So when we talk about explaining, it's having the conversation. I would engage or encourage people to sit with their family, have a family conversation. Let's all sit down and they can hear mom and dad and aunties or whoever explain that they too are feeling sadness, angst, depression, helplessness. We need to be open with those feelings and those feeling words so that they can feel free to express them to us. So you have to open that conversation. Whenever you're talking too long to teenagers, if you go too long, they're no longer with you. They may nod their head out of respect, but you don't want to talk to the point that they're no longer listening. So always engage them with questions. Say something and then ask the question back. How do you feel about that? What do you understand about what I said? But make it a back and forth conversation so you're not talking at them. Because what we do know about teenagers, respectful ones, is that they can sit there for a good minute and act like they're listening, but not hear a word that you said. You have to engage them. Ask questions. That was my two cents. Pastor Haynes, what would you say?
Amen.
Amen.
Great answer. So, Cy, we have Mr. Cyrus representing New Orleans in the building, living in Dallas now. So, Cy is asking, do you feel like the violence of property is warranted to grab the attention of the world?
And so, Cy, I'll just say that I don't judge those who are in their anger, you know, expressing it in some extreme ways. I can't judge them because, again, this has happened so often that, you know, all of us, again, if you have a conscience, if you have a heartbeat, you're going to be angry about this. And so I'm not going to judge them. I'm also watching, and I'm sure you've seen this as well, Cy, that some anarchists are using this as cover for their own abominable agenda. And so there are people engaged in some of these protests, and they are not protesting the injustice, but they're using it as an opportunity to engage in anarchy. And right. So that's why I think it's very important that we are discerning in this, because again, I mean, I've been a part of it. I've also talked to people, and you know, the reports I'm getting is that most of this is being done by people who have nothing to do with the justice movement. And so there is anger on our part, and we should be angry. But I'm also saying, okay, I I kind of see some subversive stuff happening that's doing it in the name of justice, but they're really not about justice. So I just want to make sure we're clear on that.
Yeah. And that's powerful. And that's something that I know in some of my conversations with friends, it's like, wait a minute, people, you know, there's a fight for justice. There's a true movement and a fight for justice. Then there's other things that's taking place. And I don't want people to get it misconstrued and get confused. Granted, people are reacting, but not everything is being done in the name of justice. Not everything is being done in to honor George, Ahmaud, or Brianna, and everybody else before them. So I appreciate that question. I appreciate that response. Any other questions out there? I know people have questions, and you have an open forum. Wow. Go ahead.
To address that, because I think that the way the question was worded is it warranted? And I think that to say emotions trigger things, right? And so when you have emotions, they may trigger. Now, we know that everything that's happening violent-wise and property destruction is not that of the people who are trying to seek justice. But for those that it is, when things happen and you don't address those emotions, it comes out sideways. So every time you talk about pent-up anger and hopelessness and despair and depression, those things come out sideways, whether it be in a situation like this where we're burning down targets, or a situation where you're burning down things in your home, or you're, you know, destroying relationships in your family. These things come out one way or the other. And so warranted, not necessarily from the sake of this, you should do it, but from the sake of if you don't express your feelings and what you're thinking and feeling, it will come out one way or the other. And what we're seeing is that it's coming out the other way. So
great perspective. Thank you for adding that in. Any other questions? Any other questions? Allow us to acknowledge them, address them. People are thinking things that other people are thinking. And anything out there?
Sue says, is that because we have never been taught how to express ourselves nonviolently? In part, if you think about it, as early as preschool, we tell kids, stop all that crying. Right? That's the baby's attempt to tell you something is wrong with me. And we try to mute that. Early on, the social narrative is take your emotions out of this and just think logically. And we know that when you remove emotions, you debilitate yourself. They work together. They don't work in conflict with one another. Logic and emotions go hand in hand. And when we handicap ourselves by not being able to express our emotions or utilize that feeling factor, we work at a disadvantage. So absolutely, most adults, if you ask them what are some feeling words, they're gonna come up with about three, maybe five if they're advanced. But for the most part, we don't have a very vast vocabulary as it relates to expressing how we feel, because that's not what we're taught to do. We're taught to just think, right? School is about thinking. School isn't about teaching you how to express your emotions or talk about how you're feeling. Get the work done, the end. Yeah. So yes, to your question, Sue, absolutely. We've not been taught, we've actually been discouraged from expressing emotions. One that's of the real. Common narratives is, you know, stop being a baby about it. Stop feeling so much. Just think about it logically. And that's just not how human mind works. The human works best when emotion and logic are in tandem together, not in competition.
That's good. Thank you for that. Thank you for your question, Sue. So Kiara Daniel, and I got to add this. So Kiara Daniel and I, she's my sorority sister. So shout out to the ladies of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Inc.
Well, all right.
she and I actually, excuse me, she and I actually went out on Friday. So we participated in the protest in downtown Dallas. It was nonviolent. It was one of the most powerful experiences of my lifetime. And I say one of them. And so she and I, we joined forces together. We had our Speak That Movement shirts on. We had our signs. And words can't even express what it felt like. Yeah. So for the people who are using the protests or the marches or attending the rallies as a form to express, more power to you, right? Whatever is going to help you maybe hear from others or be around that common energy. Right. So your question is, what additional actions can we take so that real change happens?
Good.
That's a Pastor Haynes question for sure.
So I'll just say this. I think it's real important. I mean, Tiara basically set the stage that you participate with organizations that are about the work of change. Right now, I think is a good time to do research on organizations that are actually doing the work. There are some phenomenal organizations out there. For example, Mothers Against Police Brutality in Dallas. They have been doing the work of basically dismantling police oppression for quite some time. And I would investigate what they're doing. One of the things that has come out is that, you know, we have, and I'll give you this, we have in Dallas, every police department in the country has a Brady list. A Brady list is a list of police officers who have demonstrated such questionable character, a lack of honesty and integrity, that they cannot be used to testify in a court of law. Hmm. Now, for me, how are you going to be a police officer and your character is already in question, so that if you arrest someone, your testimony is no good because you've made the Brady list? And so one of the things that, you know, I'm going to be calling for in the days ahead is, you know, anybody who's on the Brady list, they need to be fired. They should not be a police officer if it has been demonstrated that they lack integrity. And so when you hook up with organizations like that, that will give you information, that will let you know the kinds of what substantive, pragmatic things you can do that will take you from protest to policy change, because we do the protest in order to change policies. And so, again, that's just one of the things you can do. Here's another thing I've got to throw out. Here in Dallas, we have something, and every community has this, because environmental racism is something that is all around this nation. And that means they target communities of color, especially Black communities, with like south of downtown, we have 29 landfills. We have south of downtown something known as Shingles Mountain. And it is literally a mountain of shingles from rooftops that are no longer, you know, usable. And they built up a mountain of shingles, and it's located juxtaposed to a Black community. So my thing is, why don't we organize to attack City Hall and say, until you remove shingles from until you remove Shingles Mountain, we're coming down here every Wednesday. The other thing is, this is real simple, register and vote. Make sure that you are part of the census. You got to be counted, because that lets you know how much money and resources are funneled to certain areas. So those are some practical things that we must do. And again, the biggest thing is make yourself aware of the issues and then do what Tiara does. Tiara just shows up at stuff, you know, and if you don't show up, then guess what? You can't step up. And we need more folk who show up so they can step up.
That's right. And a lot of times, you know, you feel like there's nothing that I can do personally, right? I don't have that special talent or skill. But to Pastor Haynes' point, you connect with these organizations that are already doing the work and say, this is my skill set. I can type 50 words a minute. I can do this. I have Wednesdays off. If you need me somewhere, I can be there. You find a place that you can utilize your strengths, and then you use them. But it's a great point to connect with those that are already doing the work. And then you get the ear to the street of other things and opportunities of how you can participate.
Thank you. And thank you for that question. So Sue has another question. To add on to that question, what can we do to unify us? Sometimes we are our own worst, we are our worst enemies towards each other. So powerful question.
We change the perspective of how we see us, right? So if the way I'm going to treat other people is how I want to be treated, that in and of itself, you know, kills the problem of not wanting to be unified. If you're my sister, you're, wherever I go, no matter which city I'm in, if I see a Black person, I speak. I make it a point to speak. They may be looking at their, hello, how are you? And you let it be known that we're in the same building. It's two of us. We're going to speak. So you have to kind of walk the walk that you want. If you want unity, then you practice unity. Wherever you go, you support your people.
I love it. I love it. And I'll just add to that, it's also about respecting lanes. All of us don't do the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, my thing is, I had a shirt on earlier today that said, different methods, same message. Mm. So what I'm doing in my lane may not be what Alisha is doing in her lane or Tiara is doing in her lane, but we're all moving in the same direction. Okay. And that has to do with the uplift, the empowerment, the healing, the liberation of our people. And if we want our people liberated and healed, we want all people liberated and healed. So when you're operating in love, mm-hmm. that means that my lane ain't the only lane. And I ain't jealous of what you're doing in your lane. I ain't hating on what you're doing in your lane. As a matter of fact, I'm going to do what I can to support you in your lane. And I hope you'll do the same thing for me. So we yeah. have to grow out of this notion that everybody has to be in the same lane. As long as we're moving in the same direction, that is what this has to be about.
Powerful. So this is the last question that we'll answer, but please guys continue to ask your questions. We may not be able to get to them right now, but we'll still answer questions even after the event. So please continue to ask your questions, continue to invite more people to the conversation, because like I said, there's more to come after this Q&A. So Lisa, hello Lisa, another good friend of mine, living in Dallas now. What are your thoughts on the lack of positive responses from the person who we won't name in the White House?
Consistent. I mean,
yeah.
Consistent. I mean, it's not surprising. It's not disappointing. That's what I expect from him. He's doing exactly what he has done consistently. If nothing else, he's nothing but consistent in his disregard for the community and for issues that matter to us. So I didn't expect a response from him. I look for responses from Obama online, social media. What did my president say? My president is still President Obama. Right. And he put together a statement, and that's the statement that I look to. So I'm not surprised.
Right.
And I'll say something real quick. I will be honest. I was bothered by the response that he did put out there on Twitter. That bothered me. Again, nothing I didn't expect.
Right.
But the fact that we already have so much going on here, and for you to post what you posted about the thugs and they loot, we shoot, to me, that probably even added an extra level of anxiety, an extra level of frustration. It did not add to the solution, it added to the problem. So I just want to say that was my personal reaction to the negative response that he probably thought was positive, because right. he mentioned honoring George, where we know that was not positive and it was not good intention. So I'll let you go on that, Dr. Haynes.
Well, I just wrap it with piggybacking on Alisha with the quote from Maya Angelou: when someone shows you who they are, believe them the first time. I mean, he's just who he is. And so, you know, my thing is to always clap back at his ignorance, but at the same time, never be surprised that he is that low down, because the whole, you know, if you shoot, you know, if you loot, you know, we'll shoot. I mean, that had a racist history that went back to the 60s that was said by a racist during an uprising. And so, I mean, he knows what he's doing. And not only does he know what he's doing, but, you know, as far as I'm concerned, he's our racist in chief. And so I just have low to no expectations of him.
And as our first lady said, when they go low, we go high.
Yeah, there we go.
So thank you all for the Q&A again. Don't stop adding your questions. I appreciate the commentary. I hope you all got something out of putting your questions out there and getting some responses. So Miss Alisha, I want to thank you for the you are just, as always, amazing. I thank you for accepting the invitation to join this platform for the second time. You did it, we were years ago at BJ's when I was first having to speak that movement event. I'm like, I don't know people in Dallas. People don't know me, but I don't care. I want to have an event. So I thank you for being a part of that one years ago and coming back today. So any closing words from you before Pastor Haynes and I move on to the next segment?
I thank you for inviting me again. I appreciate it. And just like then, you called me out of the blue. I didn't know who you were, but because you were a sister and you were saying, this is what I'm starting here in Dallas, I absolutely made time to be there. And I will do that anytime that you ask me to be there, because I appreciate what you're doing and using your platform and giving me the opportunity to speak about mental health. I love it. Anytime there's an opportunity to talk about mental health, I want to be there. So I appreciate that. Thank you for doing this. Pastor Haynes, it's an honor to be here. There's a low-key, I was low-key geeked up just to know I was going to be on a panel with Pastor Freddie Haynes. So my day has been made. It was an honor. I appreciated your words as well. Thank you for that and all the work that you do. I listened to you this morning.
Thank you for your wisdom, your counsel. You are a brilliant blessing. Thank you.
Thank you. You guys have a great rest of the evening. Thank you for letting me be a part of it.
And where can people find you?
On Instagram, Finding the Foundation. And also my website is findingthefoundation.com. But at Finding the Foundation is where I'm most active. We can engage there. So please do follow me there and for other events and opportunities to hear me speak and talk about mental health.
All right. Be blessed, my sister. I'll be in touch.
Y'all have a good night. Bye-bye.
Good night.
All right, Pastor Haynes, thank you so much. Already poured in and we're not even done yet. So this is my favorite part of Speak That event. So those of you who have been rocking with me over the years, especially those of you who have attended the Speak That talks on Thursdays, every Thursday in May, you know that there's a portion at the very end where I like to interact with the special guests to talk about the Speak That Movement Four Pillars. So this is what I like to call the Speak That Speed Round. So for those of you who do not know, the four pillars of Speak That Movement are dream it, believe it, speak it, and walk it. So if somebody can throw that in the comments so that others can read it, dream it, believe it, speak it, and walk it. So Pastor Haynes, we wanna hear from you. We wanna hear from your words, as you, I think you said earlier when during your service that I listened in on, can you Freddie-nize it, or is that the word?
Oh, okay. Freddie Haynes remix. Okay.
Yeah, Freddie Haynes remix, the four pillars of Speak That Movement. So in as few words as possible for the Freddie Haynes remix, what does it mean to you to dream it?
To dream it means to never allow the current nightmare to reduce your possibilities.
Nice. Believe it.
Believers are achievers. You will not achieve if you do not believe.
Nice. Speak it.
There's power of life and death in the tongue. So your future, your blessing is at the tip of your tongue.
Powerful. So dream it, believe it, speak it. And last but certainly not least, what are your thoughts on walk it?
Walk it means you're about it, because a lot of folk talk it, but they don't walk it because they're not about it. And so everybody should go from hallelujah to do-ya-luya.
I love it. Everybody who knows how to spell add it in the comments if you know how to spell it. I will give you a special prize. Thank you for that, Pastor Haynes. So right now, I want to remove myself from this platform. I want to give you the Speak That Movement platform. And for the next few minutes, I want you to talk about the power of speaking life. Talk about life. Speak life to us. Speak life over us during this unprecedented, stressful, overwhelming time in our history. So I'm going to remove myself, give it to you. I'll come back up and we'll close out. How does that sound?
Sounds good. Thank you so much. And again, I thank Tiara. I thank all of you for tuning in. And I am so excited about Speak That Movement, because all of us have had those in our lives who have spoken into our lives that which has been poisonous or that which has activated our possibilities. I guess the best way for me to do this is to testify. My dad died when I was 14 years old. My first day of high school was the last day that my father ever lived. And so I walked into high school as a broken individual. And my first class in high school, my first period class was English. And it was a writing and composition class. And right after the funeral, I go to class for the first time. And I won't forget what happened. Miss Anderson was the teacher. I remember her to this day. Miss Anderson had us take out our piece of paper and a pen and write an essay responding to a question. The next day, we come back. She passes the essays back to us. And my essay was marked up in red. Don't forget, this is the day after my dad's funeral when I had to write that essay. My first day of high school, the last day he lived, I write the essay. The essay was whack. I mean, it was whack. I admit it was whack. But what hurt my heart was the red ink that was written across that page. And the red ink basically said, D minus, see me. And then she said, Frederick Haynes, would you please come and see me? I went up in front of my classmates and she told me what others could overhear. She said, you don't have the skills to write at the high school level. And so I'm going to put you in a remedial class because you don't have the skills to write. I ain't gonna lie. I exit the class, toe up from the floor up. I don't feel like I'm gonna get back up. As a matter of fact, I made up my mind right then and there. My dad had died. Life was not worth living, and I was going to quit school. And so I started to walk, not to the registrar's office, but instead toward the exit because I was done. And as I'm walking toward the exit, Miss Homazel Davis, after all, Miss Davis was a dynamic sister of Delta Sigma Theta sorority. Do you hear that, T? Miss Davis saw me and she said, Frederick, where are you going? School ain't out. And so I said, Miss Davis, listen, let me give you this. I gave her the paper that was marked in red that was a D minus. Miss Davis said, what? Why are you leaving? I said, because she said, I can't write. She said, your problem is not that you can't write. She can't teach. And so what I'm going to do is take you out of her class. You're not going to a remedial class. I'm going to put you in a class with someone who knows how to teach. You all, please don't miss this. Miss Anderson had spoken poison into my psyche, the psyche of a wounded, broken young man whose dad had just died, and she had no love, compassion whatsoever. Miss Davis said, it's not that you can't write, she can't teach. And then watch what Miss Davis said to me. Miss Davis said, Frederick, I see you. I know what you're going to become. You're going to become a great leader among our people. You are a gifted orator. I believe in you, Frederick. I said, but Miss Davis, I can't write. She said, you got a choice now. Are you going to listen to Miss Anderson who can't teach, or are you going to listen to Miss Davis who believes in you? And y'all, when she said that, I said, Miss Davis, okay. She said, Frederick, you go ahead, because I believe you're going to be the first Black valedictorian in the history of this high school. And y'all, from that moment on, I began to walk like a valedictorian, study like a valedictorian, think like a valedictorian. And 3 years later, I led my class down the aisle during our commencement exercises as our valedictorian. But here is the shout. The shout is the teachers were sitting on the first few rows of the auditorium and they were seated in alphabetical order. So the very first teacher who was seated at the very edge of the first aisle was Miss Anderson. I walked by her and I said to her in the words of Kool Moe Dee, how do you like me now? Not bad for a brother who cannot write. I had gone from being kicked out of her class to a remedial class into a path that set the stage for me to become, here it is, the valedictorian of my graduating class. How did that happen? It happened because someone spoke life into me. And when people speak life into you, you then have a responsibility not only to receive that life, but then you turn around and speak life into others. And that's how I wrap this. Hear those who have spoken life into your life, and then you turn around and speak life into the lives of others. And as you are speaking life into the lives of others, make sure that you speak life into yourself. Because one poet said, if you think you're beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you like to win but think you can, it's almost a sense you won't. If you think you're outclassed, you are. You've got to think high to rise. You've got to be sure of yourself if you're going to win the prize. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man, but sooner or later, the one who wins is the one who believes they can. So make sure that you think it, believe it, and then speak it, not just into your life, but into the lives of others. God bless you.
Wow. Thank you, Pastor Haynes. I hope you all receive that. I can tell from the comments, if you receive that, please throw something in the comments, a heart, a fist, champagne glasses, click clacking. I don't care what you put, but acknowledge that powerful word. So Pastor Haynes, wow, you have been more than a blessing today. Thank you for not only accepting the invitation. I asked you if you want dinner at an event. You said no, but you said yes to this, and this means more.
Thank you very much.
So thank you. So, I mean, my expectations of today's evening are exceeded. I'm never speechless, but I'm speechless. So while I still have you, Pastor Haynes, can I ask you for the biggest favor ever? Can I ask you to just pray over us, pray over all of the supporters of Speak That Movement, pray over everybody who hears the sounds of your voice, pray over everybody in this nation, pray over the people who are listening in, who have loved ones that they worry about when they leave the house, pray over our brothers who feel like, you know, they don't even know if they can be safe when they jog, safe when they're in the house, safe when they're out in the park looking at birds, safe when they made a mistake that shouldn't cost them their life, but should have just cost them a trip to the courthouse to let a jury decide their fate. So if you would just do me the honor of praying over this community, this platform, this nation, I will be forever grateful.
My honor. Thank you. And thank you again for the honor of sharing with you and your amazing audience. Shall we go to God? God, we thank you and praise you that you are a heart fixer and a mind regulator. Thank you that you move with divine intent in our lives. Thank you for how you have moved with power and purpose in the life of Tiara. I thank you for her wisdom, her spirit, her strength, and for her commitment to Speak That Movement. God, I pray your blessings upon this movement. May it be a movement that gains such meaningful and powerful steam that lives will be transformed, that our professionals who find themselves working in a corporate context that sometimes pushes back against their possibilities, that they will feel empowered as a result of this exchange, as a result of this platform, as a result of this sharing, and may they continuously speak over themselves and speak positively and powerfully and peacefully over the lives of others. And now, God, we stand in the gap for this country, a country that is sick and in need of your healing touch, a country that has a sickness that is deeper than COVID-19. God, I pray your blessings of healing. I pray, oh God, that you will move with power and grant peace and strength and hope. I pray, oh God, your special blessings upon those who sadly live in a country where their skin is criminalized and weaponized. I pray, oh God, that you will grant such healing and hope, that you, oh God, will help us to grab a hold of the truth, that just because someone else has an issue with us, it's not gonna be an issue for us. And so, God, I pray your blessings of healing and hope and guidance and strength. I pray your blessings that you, oh God, will help us to, in a very, very positive way, channel that anger And may that anger lead to action. I pray, oh God, that as anger leads to action and protest leads to possibility and policy, that you, oh God, will then use us to somehow take these tragic murders and may they become a transformational movement. Oh God, let not the deaths of Brianna, Ahmad, and George be in vain, but may we rise from the ashes in resurrection power to birth new life into this nation, into this world, into our communities, and yes, into ourselves. Thank you now for the power of prayer. We rise from our knees so our prayers are activated through our feet, and use us now to turn this world upside down. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen, and amen. Wow, everybody, please give it up virtually for this man of God, prophetic pastor of Friendship West Baptist Church in Dallas, social activist, just, I don't even have enough words. I'm speechless, and I'm so honored. You just blessed this platform. I received everything you said, and I hope everybody else out there by the sound of your voice. I want to speak over your life, and I don't know where this is coming from, but I want to tell you that we honor you. You are here for a reason. I mean, generations ago, God knew that we needed you for a time like these. You have stayed in the forefront. You have been unapologetic. You have shared the things that others feel but are not boldly saying. You have been a leader in a community where we need leadership. You have transformed the way people think, the way people believe. So I honor you. I thank you. I wish nothing but blessings upon blessings upon blessings on your church, on your platform, on your life, on the lives of everybody attached to you. So I thank you so much. And guys, if you want to find Pastor Haynes, you can go to his church's website. I mean, you can Google him. I mean, he's Googleable. And I want to thank you. I will be sending you a special gift. I created these. I speak life over Black lives. I speak life over my life. I speak life over my family. I created this line because I just want us to continually spread the message. So I will be sending you a shirt. I also want to send you some face coverings to Speak That Movement face covering. I speak life over Black lives face covering. I just want to extend it to you. You don't have to wear it if you don't want to.
I'll wear it. Thank you.
I just want you to have it to let you know that I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Tons of comments. So after this, maybe you could take a look at in the comments. People are thanking you. Please know that you just blessed this platform. It will never be the same. Again, I thank you. I honor you. And I wish you nothing but the best. And I know our paths will cross again. So don't forget about little old Tiara M. Tucker.
Bless you.
Because I'll be in touch.
Thank you so much. And thank you for the opportunity.
And any final words as you close out? I mean, you said so much, but anything else that you want to say as you close out?
Keep speaking that movement.
Wow. Thank you so much, Pastor.
Thank you.
I'm usually not speechless, but this was so powerful. I hope you all felt the energy. I hope you all felt the passion. I hope you all felt the power in that. And I also hope that you felt and understand the power of speaking words into the atmosphere, the power of speaking things into existence, to understand the strength and the courage to stand up for what you believe in. And I know, because I'm a business professional, I'm a believer. I know it's challenging sometimes when on one side you want to be a radical, but then on the other side you're like, man, but I got to work Monday. You know, I can't clown. And not that we're trying to clown it in a negative way. So I just hope that you heard some things today from Alisha, from Pastor Haynes, that touched your lives, that gave you powerful words that you can share when you have conversations with others, whether it's your friends, your family, your loved ones, people within your circle, and also people outside of your circle. So I am so grateful for everybody that joined in today. Thank you for standing to the end. Thank you if you hosted a watch party. Continue to share this message. It will be available on the Speak That Movement page. So continue to share the conversation. Let's spread this the way that we're spreading everything else out there, because life was spoken today. And again, Speak That Movement on Facebook. And I just want to throw this out there as well. I'm excited to announce my new website. Well, actually, it's been revamped. If you want to learn more about Tiara PR Network or Speak That Movement, please go to the website, check it out. It's www.tiaraprnetwork.com. If you're interested in any of the items that you might have seen me and some of my friends out wearing, you know, while we've been engaging in the activities taking place for justice, all of that is out on the website. Again, this is not a sales pitch. I don't do what I do to make a dollar. I do what I do because I believe in it. So if you want to support the movement, or just have something to maybe visually express what you're feeling, there's t-shirts out there, there's face coverings out there. The Speak That Movement Vision and Empowerment calendars are also out there as well. We're still in May, y'all. Like, it feels like we should be putting the 2020 calendar away because we've experienced so much. So there's still so many more months left in this year. So I promise you that calendar out there will bless you. Every month it is intended to empower you, to make you put things into the atmosphere, to think about your visions, think about your dreams. Finally, thank you for supporting Tiara PR Network and Speak That Movement. May God bless you. May God protect you. Continue to share this. Continue to interact in the comments. And as I close out, I want to thank everybody that's been rocking with this movement. The list is going on and on and on. So I thank you all. And I want to close us out with this powerful video.
Mama, Mama, we don't need you yesterday. Oh, nothing better. We're only looking half of me. You know we got to find a way to bring some love in. Oh, yeah. Ticket lights, ticket sign, punish me with brutality. Talk to me, only so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Hey, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. Ooh. Thank you.
What's going on right now?